Good evening. I'm Amna Nawaz. Jeff Bennett is away. On the NewsHour tonight, Gaza reels from devastating overnight airstrikes on refugee camps as Egypt floats a proposal to end the Israel-Hamas war. Online safety, allegations that Facebook and Instagram ignored warnings that the social media platforms were harming young users. And a preview of next year's legislative sessions as state lawmakers meet what bills and priorities are on the horizon in 2024.
When I talk to legislators, almost no matter what issue we're talking about, the underlying issue is a workforce issue.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Kathy and Paul Anderson, and Camilla and George Smith.
Consumer Cellular, this is Sam.
How may I help you?
This is a pocket dial. Well, somebody's pocket.
Thought I'd let you know that with Consumer Cellular,
you get nationwide coverage with no contract. That's kind of our thing.
Have a nice day.
Actually, you don't need vision to do most things in life. It's exciting to be part of a team driving the technology forward. I think that's the most rewarding thing. People who know BDO.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to the NewsHour. The Israeli military says it has expanded its ground offensive in the Gaza Strip. Operations now include the densely populated urban refugee camps in the central part of the territory. That comes as the United Nations appoints a new coordinator for humanitarian aid to Gaza, where the UN says more than 2 million people are in a food crisis and the risk of famine grows each day.
At the Burij camp in central Gaza, these families are on the move again, heeding Israeli warnings to evacuate. But safety in Gaza is hard to find. Riyad Abdul Salam said even evacuating is dangerous.
They threw leaflets at us and told us to get out with our hands above our heads. They shot F-16 bullets and rounds of gunfire around us. We have been forced out.
The continued Israeli strikes hit even so-called safe zones. Mariam Al-Omsi has lived through decades of conflict.
75 years of suffering, our rights taken, our country seized, and our people slaughtered.
Yesterday, Egypt and Qatar presented a plan to end the war, but neither Israel nor Hamas publicly embraced the idea of a ceasefire. Instead, the conflict has boiled over into the region. The Iranian-backed popular mobilization forces marched through Baghdad today with the coffin of a fighter who was killed by an American airstrike.
It is another crime added to America's black criminal record.
President Biden ordered the strike after a drone attack injured three American service members in northern Iraq. It was claimed by Iranian-backed militant groups, one of a slew of Iran proxy attacks against the U.S. in recent weeks. Iranian-backed Houthi militants in Yemen have continued to launch missiles towards commercial ships on the Red Sea. They also sent a barrage towards the Israeli city of Eilat. Israel joined the fray, killing a high-ranking Iranian general in an airstrike outside of Damascus, Syria.
Our reaction to the assassination will be smart, strong, and with the necessary effectiveness in a way that the Zionist regime will not have any possibility to use the response in its complicated purposes.
Israeli Defense Minister Yoav Gallant defended the military actions in front of the Knesset.
We are in a multi-front war, and I say here in the most explicit way, anyone who acts against us is a potential target. There is no immunity for anyone.
Meanwhile, Israeli operations in the West Bank have expanded. The IDF said they confiscated weapons and destroyed an explosives lab near the Nur Shams refugee camp. As IDF troops move through Gaza, Israeli officials pledge to finish their mission. Overhead, the Iron Dome continues to intercept Hamas rockets targeting Israel, and a chance for peace seems far away.
Late today, the Pentagon said a U.S. warship shot down 12 drones, 3 anti-ship ballistic missiles, and 2 land attack cruise missiles that were fired by the Yemen-based Houthis. Meanwhile, the death toll in Gaza is nearing 21,000, mostly women and children, according to Palestinian officials. And the path to a real political solution to the end of the war still seems far off. To discuss what this means for Palestinians trapped in Gaza, I spoke earlier today with Palestinian political analyst Noor Oded. Noor, welcome back to the NewsHour. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me, Amna.
I'd love to ask you about this proposed peace plan that we saw put forward yesterday by Egypt and Qatar. It essentially calls for a ceasefire, calls for the phased release of hostages held by Hamas and also Palestinians held by Israel, and for a united technocratic Palestinian government that would oversee Gaza and the West Bank. Just when you saw this peace plan, what was your take? What did you make of it?
Well, I mean, it wasn't very surprising in its attempt to phase in a permanent ceasefire, so to speak, because it does seem that the parties are very far apart. But I was a bit puzzled that the Egyptians would also include negotiations with Israel and the U.S., really, on the internal Palestinian issue of who governs and how, because this is a very contentious issue and a very delicate one. And I think it would have been much easier for Egypt to kind of do a little bit of, you know, housekeeping with the Palestinians first before it kind of put it out there for everybody to weigh in. And now we know that pretty much everybody has said no to the proposal.
Well, we know Hamas's opposition reportedly is based on the fact that they don't want anyone else to run Gaza, right? So set aside for a moment what Israel would or wouldn't sign on to. Mm. Would Hamas support a peace plan that doesn't include them in charge? Would Palestinians support Hamas not being in charge?
Well, I think this is not a zero-sum game. I think Hamas would be open to a formulation where it remains part of the political scene because that is inevitable. There's no way that Hamas is going to cease to exist. And everybody, I think, has to come to terms with that. But to have a technocratic government, I don't think would be a contentious issue. It's more the other details of how this would happen, how unity would come about, what kind of role would Hamas have in the wider political context in the Palestinian political scene. These are things that Palestinians need to agree on and that, quite frankly, the world has to come to terms with, because if this veto on who is an acceptable Palestinian political player continues, then there is more of a chance that this war will continue, will persist, and we will see more death and destruction until the reality set in and people understand that there's no way you can cancel an ideology or prevent a significant player from taking part in Palestinian politics without setting everybody up for civil war.
But Noor, as you know, Israel has said that one of their main goals, one of their prerequisites here, is that Hamas is eradicated. So what does a future with Hamas look like in Gaza? Are you saying there's a difference between the political wing surviving without the military wing? Would Israel ever accept that?
Well, I'm not sure we need Israel's opinion on this because, quite frankly, Palestinians don't get to have a say about who the Israelis have in government. And right now in Israel, you have a man who's been convicted 8 times of terrorism-related charges in Israel as the Minister of National Security. You have a self-avowed fascist in charge of Palestinian affairs and the Ministry of Finance. So it should not be up to the Israelis. The Hamas is not only present in Gaza, and so degrading its military capability, toppling its de facto government in Gaza doesn't mean that Hamas is going to cease to exist. And that's really the reality I'm talking about. We need to understand that the Palestinian political scene is not exclusive to Gaza, and it is much wider than that. It It's in the West Bank. It's also in exile. And Palestinians need to be able to come up with a formula that they can live with and that can be functional and inclusive and representative in order for things to move forward and in order for dialogue about ending the occupation and the root cause of all this misery can actually commence with international support.
Nur, all of this is coming as there's another conversation in Israel, more public now, about the displacement of Palestinians. Mm. There was an opinion piece published by the Jerusalem Post by an academic named Joel Roskin, who's a geologist at Bar-Ilan University. The title of that was, Why Moving to the Sinai Peninsula is the Solution for Gaza's Palestinians. There's also been reports recently about Prime Minister Netanyahu talking about supporting voluntary migration of Palestinians to other countries. What do you make of this conversation becoming more public now?
Well, I think that the Israelis are more comfortable talking about a potential atrocity crime, as experts of international law have warned. In my opinion, this was the plan all along, starving a population, depriving them of food and water, destroying the infrastructure, breaking down the health system, making sure that the region occupied now is basically uninhabitable and pushing the majority of the population into a small, tiny portion at the Egyptian border. It was all meant to kind of nudge the population, if not outright forcibly expel it into the Sinai. And now they're more comfortable saying that, probably because they haven't really had any pushback about all the other violations of international law that have been committed for over 80 days now.
Well, Israel, I must put to you, will say this has all been about national security, right? That October 7th changed everything. The steps that they're taking now are to make sure that that horrific day never happens again. What would you say to that?
Well, it's convenient to kind of put a line in the sand and start counting from October 7th. But everybody understands around the world that this didn't start on October 7th. The Palestinians have been enduring a reality of persecution and dispossession and Israeli foreign occupation for 75 years. That's really at the heart of all of this. And the fact that it's been a political dead end for Palestinians, that you have an Israeli prime minister who's committed publicly to preventing the realization of Palestinian self-determination, of Palestinian statehood. That's what got us here, in addition to international complacency, I have to say. So one would hope that out of all of this tragedy, out of this misery and these atrocities now committed, the world would understand that they need to change the playbook and they need to answer those root causes. Otherwise, we're going to end up right where we started with the seeds of future conflicts, very present and very ripe for the picking.
Political analyst Nur Odeh joining us tonight from Ramallah. Nur, thank you for your time.
Thank you for having me.
In the day's other headlines, the UN's nuclear watchdog reports that Iran has increased its production of near-weapons-grade uranium. The International Atomic Energy Agency said Tehran has been producing more highly enriched uranium since late November, reversing a months-long slowdown. UN inspectors observed the increase at facilities in Natanz and Fordo. Ukrainian warplanes attacked a Russian landing ship in the Black Sea off Russian-occupied Crimea. Video showed a massive explosion in the night sky. Ukrainian officials said the ship, which they believe was carrying ammunition and drones, was destroyed. The 360-foot-long vessel was also capable of carrying 10 tanks and more than 200 sailors. Officials in Nigeria say attackers armed with guns and machetes killed at least 140 people in a weekend rampage. The assailants burned down houses in 17 remote villages in the north-central state of Plateau. Locals blamed nomadic herders who've clashed for decades with farmers over access to land and water. It is the deadliest violence Nigeria has seen since 2018. A fierce winter storm swept across much of the central U.S. today, making for treacherous holiday travel. Parts of the Dakotas, Kansas, Nebraska, and Colorado were under blizzard warnings. In Nebraska, heavy snow and strong winds created hazardous conditions. In the meantime, frozen roads in North Dakota turned slick neighborhood streets into ice skating rinks. Thousands of migrants are trekking through southern Mexico en route to the U.S. border. Mexican authorities are reportedly making no attempts to stop the caravan as they pass through immigration inspection checkpoints. The group of about 6,000 people walked along highways today, some carrying children, hoping for a better life when they reach the U.S. border.
We are looking to improve ourselves, to have a better quality of life, because in our country, the situation is getting worse and worse. What we're looking for is to work. We are not criminals. We are not bad people.
U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken and Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas are traveling to Mexico City tomorrow to negotiate an agreement on the flow of migrants to the U.S. And on Wall Street, stocks kicked off this final week of trading on a higher note. The Dow Jones Industrial Average gained 159 points to close at 37,545. The Nasdaq rose 81 points and the S&P 500 added 20. Still to come on the NewsHour, a look at the priorities for state governments in 2024. The effect of the Israel-Hamas war on Israel's agricultural supply. And as this year comes to an end, a look at the best TV shows of 2023.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
This past year saw a notable change as both state and federal governments became more aggressive about taking big tech to court. The U.S. Department of Justice and Google are awaiting the verdict of a landmark antitrust trial that alleges Google's anti-competitive behavior led to its dominance. And Meta is now the target of state lawsuits, alleging it harmed the mental health of kids and misled the public about online safety. Stephanie Tsai focuses on that part of the story.
Now, more than 40 states and the District of Columbia filed lawsuits against Meta, the parent company of Facebook, Instagram, and WhatsApp. State attorneys general argue that Facebook and Instagram deliberately manipulate their apps in ways that addict kids and teens and have failed to keep them off, despite age limits. Colorado Attorney General Phil Weiser helped lead the lawsuit.
Meta, under federal law, cannot and should not be marketing to young people, collecting data without parents' awareness or consent. They're doing just that. Meta has identified young people, 11, 12-year-olds, as an untapped and valuable audience and engaged in behavior in violation of federal law.
There have been multiple stories as well focusing on Meta's struggles to protect kids from online predators and even promoting pedophile accounts through its algorithms. Jeff Horowitz's reporting in the Wall Street Journal has led to increased public and legal scrutiny of social media, and it's the focus of his new book, Broken Code, Inside Facebook and the Fight to Expose Its Harmful Secrets. Jeff, thanks so much for joining the NewsHour. The state's lawsuit, I want to go back to that. It claims that Meta has misled the public about the risks to teens and younger children. You published an investigation recently about pedophiles on the platform. Talk about some of the disturbing things you found.
Sure. I think all of this kind of goes back to the platforms being very good at deliberately seeking out sort of communities that are willing to consume content voraciously and then serving it up to them. And, you know, that can be good. That can connect you with useful hobbies. It can also connect people who desperately want to believe the 2020 or the 2024 election is being stolen, for that matter. And it can connect people who wish to sexualize children. And so the system is really good at that. It is extremely good at personalization. The problem is that it frequently is operating well beyond the capacity of even the people who run it to understand and intervene to stop harmful outcomes.
Okay, so in this research, I understand you set up a test account on Facebook, and it led you down a pretty dark path. For example, you found a group where hundreds of thousands of people who were interested in incest had joined, correct?
I wish we'd found only one. This is very consistent. The platform and its groups you should join algorithm basically will, as soon as you start following just a couple of kind of slightly suspect entities, will start pushing hard into like increasingly dark content. I mean, like really really just like awful things involving the kidnapping of children was literally a subject of one group. And this is routine. The company has tried to work on cleaning that system up. We spent 6 months sort of noting to them where they were coming up short. And it is an ongoing problem to this day.
And you have another article out just in the last few days about Meta's introduction of encrypted messaging on Facebook and Instagram. Talk about how your reporting shows the impact that can have on efforts to stop child exploitation on the platform.
Yeah, so for years, encryption has been something where sort of privacy advocates are in favor, law enforcement and governmental groups are against because, you know, it impedes investigations. I think something that has kind of gone unnoticed, but will perhaps soon be noticed because Meta is adopting end-to-end encryption on both Facebook and Instagram, is how this technology, when used, paired with a fully public social network, becomes something potentially really volatile and potentially really useful for predation. Because having one entity that is attempting to sort of prey on another group, whether that's for human trafficking, child exploitation, recruitment of people for drug cartels, and not having any insight into the system is something that is really going to be a problem for certain efforts to combat that stuff. So in other words, if you can't actually investigate the networks using the methods that traditionally these investigations have been done with, you're going to have sort of groups such as those large pedophile groups that are actively connecting people and then sending them pretty much straight into the dark web.
And law enforcement, you've given examples, have used messaging and their ability to access that messaging for prosecution. Meta, of course, believes that privacy is the goal here, and that's why they want the encryption. Meta has also issued responses to your reporting, including the recent report on pedophile content on the platform, in which they say, "We work hard to stay ahead. That's why we hire specialists dedicated to online child safety, develop new technology that roots out predators, and we share what we learn with other companies and law enforcement." The statement goes on to say, "We are actively continuing to implement changes identified by the task force we set up earlier this year." Jeff, that's a reference to the child task force that was set up after your reporting in June about explicit child content on Instagram. My question is, has Meta addressed all the issues you've uncovered in your reporting, and that's in your book?
Certainly not on any of those fronts. No, the task force has been shut down. They haven't really paid much attention to that or highlighted that much. And even though the problems are still ongoing, no, I think there are some fundamental questions of the platform wanting to not take responsibility for the ways that it's has reformulated human communication. You know, this is something where, you know, like, oh, this is just the internet. You know, people do bad things on the internet. Who are we to, who are we to be able to stop that? The issue that arises here is that none of the communities that exist on these platforms are ones that would form in real life.
Jeff Horowitz, author of the new book, Broken Code, thank you so much for joining the NewsHour.
Thank you.
The addictive nature of social media doesn't just have parents, lawmakers, and advocates worried. Last year, more than half of U.S. teens said it would be difficult to give up social media, including TikTok and YouTube. The latest episode of our Student Reporting Lab series, Moments of Truth, tells the story of one teen named Connor who faced this dilemma head-on with Instagram.
When I first saw you over Zoom, I was like, wow, that guy looks kind of interesting. And then I just remember standing next to you in choir every day. Due to proximity, we just became friends.
Yeah, I was kind of experiencing this weird, great loneliness period in my life. I'm diagnosed with bipolar and OCD. And I think I was going through a rough patch at the time. So that friendship was almost like of holy stature. I started like relying on you to make it through the day. We started sharing locations around then.
I could kind of see the obsession starting. I remember getting like super worried about you, and I wanted to help you, but I didn't know how.
I had kind of a lack of self-control. Like, I would repeatedly check and check and check. The accessibility that the internet has to kind of enable that really did not help. And I don't think that a 15-year-old kind of had that self-control.
You were DMing me like every hour about like how sucky everything was. It was kind of unwelcome. Since it was so frequent and so often, I gave like one word responses and stuff, and I was also going through a lot at that point in time. It had really just become a lot to handle, like the problems of two people. I came up to you, I told you that I needed to like distance myself from this relationship that we had.
So when we weren't talking, I tried not to really open Instagram that much. I learned to practice self-control because the thing is, if I allow myself to consistently check the locations and consistently check the little active thing on Instagram DM, then I know I'm gonna spiral. And once I'm in that obsessive state, it's hard to get out of it. Now that at least I'm less connected, there's more of an open space for us.
We just go on walks. We'll go to Goodwill sometimes.
When someone's actions and what someone's doing is accessible to you at all times, I don't think that's how humanity is intended to be.
It's unnatural.
It's unnatural for you to have access to what someone's doing all the time. It's also a sign that maybe you're focusing on that person more than yourself.
I am just grateful it worked out, I think, and how stable our relationship is. It's been a ride.
A beautiful ride.
Yeah.
Repeated gridlock in Washington has brought about the rise of another power center in America, state legislatures. Lisa Desjardins explores what to expect in the coming year.
In 2024, lawmakers in state houses from California to Kentucky are poised to wrestle with major issues in American life. Joining us now to preview an important year ahead is Reed Wilson, founder of Pluribus News, which focuses on state-level news and policy. Reed, we've heard a lot about deficits, national debt on the federal level. States have a bit of a different situation. Most of them have to have balanced budgets. But I want to ask you, what is the fiscal picture like? What are the bank accounts looking like for states right now?
Well, there's good news and bad news. This year, states are on track to spend $1.26 trillion, which is more than they've ever spent before. The bad news is that the good times are ending and the era of pandemic era massive budgets are fading a little bit as the federal money runs out. Most states are still taking in much more revenue than they did pre-pandemic. There are some bleak spots. In California, they're in a $68 billion budget hole. The good news is that a lot of these states were anticipating a downturn and they saved more money than they'd ever had before in their rainy day funds. So a lot of these states are set up to keep operating for half a year, 9 months, an entire year without raising any additional revenue if the economy really turns south.
But when I hear states looking at a little bit tighter of a budget picture, I also wonder about taxes.
Yeah, in some cases, legislators are starting to talk about raising taxes, but in most cases, legislators are talking about cutting taxes still, especially in places like Georgia, Florida. We're likely to see more tax cuts this year because a lot of these states are still taking in much more revenue than they did before the pandemic, and because of things like a booming housing market, property taxes are rising, and so legislators are reacting to that, trying to lower that property tax burden that's unexpectedly falling on their residents.
From surveying the national landscape on the state level, what do you think is the biggest issue overall that you see across states?
When I talk to legislators, almost no matter what issue we're talking about, the underlying issue is a workforce issue. The baby boomer generation is retiring. In its place, the Gen X, the millennials and Gen Z, there aren't enough of them to fill those jobs. when I started covering states, you know, a decade and a half ago, a lot of what I heard from governors was, hey, we stole this business from another state. We recruited this business successfully. Now when I'm talking to governors and legislators, they're talking about stealing workers and attracting workers successfully. That's an incredible sea change. And it speaks to the lack of employees there are to fill state government jobs, to fill teaching jobs. I mean, we see this when you walk into a restaurant and half the tables are empty because they don't have enough servers. The same thing is happening in corrections, in high-tech manufacturing, basically any issue across the country. You know, Governor Kristi Noem of South Dakota a couple of months ago said that basically the state that has the workforce is going to win the future. I think she was exactly right.
Huh. One other thing about states is that most of them, most of these state legislatures in 2024 are either Republican-led, both chambers, or Democrat-led. I think there's just one, Pennsylvania, that in 2024 will have split chambers. So I want to kind of break down the different agendas. When you look at those Democrat-led states, let's start with them. What do you think the agenda looks like in those legislatures?
Well, and I've been talking to state legislative leaders about their priorities over the next year in just the last few weeks, and a lot of them are telling me that they're going to be focusing on housing and homelessness, which are sort of twin crises that are working together. There is simply not enough housing in America. It takes a long time to build all of that new stock. So in the sort of short run, states are going to be, the blue states are going to be working on things like rent stabilization, trying to keep more people in their homes and avoid an eviction crisis like we avoided in the early days of the pandemic. The second thing I think we'll see is a lot of measures on gun safety, trying to limit assault-style weapons, high-capacity magazines, and the sort of key here is that all of these states are working under the new guidance of the U.S. Supreme Court, which has struck down a number of blue state gun safety laws in recent years. They're trying to figure out what the justices will allow and just how far they can push some of this legislation.
What about Republican states?
In Republican states, I think we can focus a lot on those tax cuts that I talked about, teacher retention, workforce retention, and healthcare retention, especially in a state like Florida. The big initiative this year is going to be on trying to attract more healthcare workers to a fast-growing state that's older than the national average. There are going to be a lot of seniors in Florida who need that kind of care. So they're working on things like licensure reform. If you're a doctor or a registered nurse in one state, if you move to Florida, your license can follow you there under a lot of the reforms that they've been talking about. A lot of red states are working on that sort of licensure reform, because a surprising number of jobs require a professional license. They want to reduce the barriers to entry, make sure that you can take your job with you effectively.
It is all about the economy in 2024. Reed Wilson, thank you so much.
Thank you, Lisa.
Long-term care is already a huge problem in the United States, one that's growing as the baby boom population ages and one with big financial costs. William Brangham looks at the impact this is having on middle-class Americans and how they're having to rearrange their lives.
The numbers alone give a very stark sense of what America is facing. Between now and 2030, every single day, about 10,000 baby boomers will turn 65. By 2050, there will be 85 million Americans 65 and over. 19 million of them will be 85 or older. Already, the total cost of long-term care for the elderly is around $500 billion every year. A new series by KFF Health News and the New York Times called Dying Broke looks at the financial and emotional consequences of inadequate long-term care, a circumstance that often leaves middle-class Americans in financial ruin. The series profiles people who have had to spend down their life savings to qualify for government help, and it reveals a largely broken private insurance market. Jordan Rao of KFF Health News was one of the lead reporters on this series. Jordan, thank you so much for being here. The series title, Dying Broke, is so sobering, as are many of the profiles of the stories that you tell. Broadly speaking, can you lay out the problem that you document here?
Thanks for having me. What our series looked at was long-term care for the elderly in particular. And these are people who need personal aids because they can't do basic activities of daily life, like making meals, getting up, going to the bathrooms, or people that have cognitive impairments like dementia. And a lot of people think that Medicare covers this, but that's not the case. It doesn't cover any of that. So our series looked at this huge gap in support for American families. Some people have taken out long-term care insurance, but in fact, it's a small amount, and that market is pretty broken and doesn't work. And so, as you said, a lot of people end up just being left to their own devices. They spend enormous amounts of their own life savings, and often they have to rely on friends or family. And a lot of the series looked at the family members who have made enormous sacrifices to help their parents.
Yeah, one of the many stories, they're all quite profound, but one of the stories you tell is about Gay Glenn and her mother, Betty Ann. Can you tell us a little bit about their story?
Sure. Gay moved from Chicago to Kansas when her mother had dementia and needed to be in a nursing home. And so she moved there to both help her and also to sort out her finances. The nursing home costs over $10,000 a month. And she had to hire a lawyer, as many people have to do, just to figure out how to get her mother to a point where she could qualify for Medicaid. So Medicaid, as we touched on, is the federal state program that does cover, provide long-term care for people, but you have to have almost no assets in many states and very little income. So you basically have to be destitute. And Gay was working on this. At the same time, she had to figure out what to do with her mother's house, and she had to give up a lot of her own career and personal desires to help her mother. And meanwhile, she was living in, her mother had a very modest rental apartment, and Gay was living there. And because of the Medicaid rules, she actually had to be paying rent to her mother and struggling with all that. And she spent, the mother ended up spending down getting on Medicaid. And then right before she died, they sold the house and she was off Medicaid. So it was really a complete view of just how Byzantine this system is for people and how draining it can be both emotionally and financially.
Byzantine is such a good word for it. I mean, if a family finds that they do have to pay out of pocket for this type of care, what's the range of costs they could expect to pay?
Well, it depends on what your care choice is. So you can try and have aides at home, and that's difficult to find these days because there's such a shortage. Many people want to go into assisted living facilities, which are a step less intense than a skilled nursing facility. And those facilities can cost anywhere. $3,000 is the bare minimum almost everywhere. And if you have dementia or extensive needs, it can be as high as $15,000 a month. So that's what people are looking for. And the same thing, you know, depending on how much care you need, if you thought you could get 24-hour personal care at home, it can be as expensive. So it can be debilitating for all but the very richest Americans.
And what are the other kinds of experiences? I know you profiled a whole slew of families, but can you tell us a little bit about some of the other experiences that people had?
We wrote about people who went into assisted living facilities and the way that they were billed. They were often, charged very specific moments for every minute that they got care. And that was in the original contracts. But as their needs increased and got worse, often the costs would increase astronomically. So we wrote a lot about them and also about that industry, which is a very profitable one, owned by some very large real estate investment trusts, a number of them, not all the facilities. And we also looked at whether those places always deliver on the care that they promise and people are paying so lavishly for.
You also detail a few different attempts during the Obama administration and then more recently in the Biden administration to try to address this, and either those efforts either failed to launch or never were passed. But you also report how the way that the U.S. cares for its elderly population is so different than our other peer nations in Europe and elsewhere. Can you explain that?
Sure. So the United States spends significantly less on long-term care than most other wealthy nations. Now, at the most lavish, the most generous is a place like the Netherlands, where they have a publicly funded insurance program as well as other programs, and you're really taken care of well. But other countries have a whole slew of things that we don't have. For instance, in Japan, they assign a care manager to help you navigate this Byzantine system that we talked about. And other places have more generous financial aid so that you don't have to be totally bankrupt. And so that's what we looked around at other countries and really found the United States fares very poorly in comparison.
All right, the series is called Dying Broke. Jordan Rao of KFF Health News, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much for having me.
When Hamas attacked Israel on October 7th and Israel declared war, most foreign farm workers left the country and Palestinian workers were barred from entering Israel. As journalist John Frankel discovered, many Israelis were called to reserve duty, leaving the farming industry facing financial losses and in desperate need of workers.
The people of Israel say that they are in a fight for their lives and their land. While at war with Hamas, there is another front. Right under their feet. A battle to save their crops and a large part of their food supply. Some of those killed and kidnapped on October 7th were, like these field workers, from Thailand. They come in 5-year cycles to work on farms across Israel. Fearing for their safety, many left.
We used to have 20 workers, Thai, and that stay here usually for 5 years, so they really know everything about the land, tractors, everything. And then one day we were left with 2 workers that decided to stay, all the rest went back home.
Liat Maimon Malouf helps run her family farm, 40 minutes north of Gaza and within rocket range, alongside her husband Gidon. The Thai workers they came to rely on dominated the agricultural landscape. Without them, the industry screeched to a halt.
Can you quantify
How much money
you may have lost?
I still don't know how much, but it's a lot. It's a lot. Because it takes 3 months to grow cauliflower, and all that you put into these 3 months, from paying the workers, from water, from planting, from everything, it's gone because you cannot pick it up and it just sits there.
On another farm nearby, it's no different. Moral Gabi says he lost nearly $275,000 in those first couple of weeks. But you cannot stop nature and growth. The vegetables don't see the pain, feel the wounds, or hear the sounds of war.
Can you hear the bombs?
Though muffled, indeed you can. But despite that, Sharon Golan-Bear, a fashion designer, and her colleagues took a day off to work the fields. Desperate to harvest the crops, farmers couldn't be picky. They needed many hands, much less strong backs, and put the word out on social media.
What made you come out here today and volunteer on the farm?
When I'm touching like the ground, it feels like it was something that we were meant to do.
The volunteers who are working this farm today have come from near and far. Some have come day after day, others are newcomers. They've all served the required time in the Israeli military. And like the reservists from around the country who have been called to duty, these people also feel they've been called to serve their country in a different way.
Everybody's doing something to feel more significant in this fight.
Which is also why I came to Israel for a week. I wanted to lend my hands and make the land grow. Today, planting cauliflower. In a national effort to get the farms back up and running, the military also is now deploying soldiers to farmland.
This is one of the proudest moments of my Army service.
For real?
Yeah. I'm a technician, so it's hard to see the fruits of your labor when you're a technician. I rig antennas. But this farming now is needed more than ever.
Like many, Avishai Pony hadn't had time off since the war began. This is how he spent his first free day.
It's something I can do. I don't know to how to go to the high-tech, for example, to head there. I don't know to go to another place to do it, to do what the other guys do. But here it's something, it's a simple work, and that I can do, and I'm happy to do it, and I hope I can work. But it's go around, because if I not work, we have no food in the supermarket.
To the north in the Jordan Valley, on Moshav Yardena, the owners of this farm also lost most of their foreign workers. And so I found myself picking tomatoes, trying to keep up with the next generation.
This place, this land, is very important to me and to all of us, basically.
Ronnie Lev and her friends have been volunteering 4 days a week.
I did other jobs as well, like I did dates, like we picked dates and bananas, but I really like tomatoes, so.
Do you want to be a tomato farmer or a farmer at all?
I don't think so.
We can do it because we're young and we're strong and we have the time.
The Almiara is also part of Mechina, a gap year program before these students join the military.
It's important, it's fun. You can see we're picking tomatoes, we're laughing, we're dancing.
We work with music, we dance, we laugh together.
Gal Berkovich is 19 years old.
If we won't dance, then like who will dance? I think it's kind of symbolic that people lost their lives dancing at the party, and like here we are dancing for them. It's kind of part of the deal. I'm really all for the morale. If we lose our morale, then we lose our spirit. And so I believe I'm doing something good.
Back on the cauliflower farms, the size and number of fields that need planting is daunting for such a small and inexperienced crew. But with each row, there is progress. You can see what is and what it will be. Is this what a soldier does?
Usually not.
Yair Lehman works logistics in the IDF. How does it feel to be volunteering here when you know that your brothers and sisters in arms are fighting a war right now?
Actually, my best friends are in the commando and in the tank units in Shiryon. It's a little bit disappointing, to be honest, but once I see, as we planted everything, I can see that I am helping the future. While they are helping the present, we are taking care of the future of the country to make sure our country grows.
And what is growing is being harvested on time. Helping cut losses and getting the food to market, the volunteers are making a difference. And the farmers are settling into a new routine. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm John Frankel from Moshav Chatzav in the southern part of Israel.
In the age of streaming, there is never a lack of something to watch. The choices are nearly overwhelming. Jeffrey Brown consults some critics as part of our arts and culture series, Canvas.
And to help guide us through this year's best shows, I'm joined by Lorraine Ali, the news and culture critic of the LA Times, and Jen Chaney, TV critic for Vulture and New York Magazine. And hello to both of you. Thanks for joining us. Why don't we start with new shows? Jen Chaney, you want to start? Give us two.
Sure. One of the big shows of the year, especially early in the year, was The Last of Us, which was a big HBO series based on a very popular, enduring video game. Also telling a story of a pandemic, but a different kind of pandemic, but certainly shades of that catastrophic situations that people have to endure through. I thought it was a wonderful series with two terrific lead performances from Pedro Pascal and Bella Ramsey.
Connected with people because of that sense of out of time.
Yes. So I thought that was a terrific show. Another really great new show that I feel like not enough people watched is Mrs. Davis. It was on Peacock. Mm-hmm. It was created by Tara Hernandez and Damon Lindelof, who created Lost and Watchmen. And it's so hard to explain this show in a brief manner, but it's about a nun who is opposed to this algorithm that is everybody's kind of using to guide their lives. And the algorithm challenges her that if she finds the Holy Grail, the algorithm will delete itself.
The Holy Grail. So what now?
A nun, an algorithm, and the Holy Grail.
Right? I mean, we've seen it 1,000 times, but it's really good in this particular instance.
All right, Lorraine, Ali, do you have two new shows?
My first one is one that I don't feel like a lot of people saw. It's called The Horror of Dolores Roach. And it is a dark comedy, kind of along the lines of a Sweeney Todd urban tale mixed with horror. And it takes place in a gentrified neighborhood in New York. And this woman gets out of prison. She's played by Justina Machado, who you might know from One Day at a Time, the reboot, and also from 6 Feet Under. She gets out of prison, returns to her old neighborhood, only to find that it's totally been gentrified. How does she survive? She moves in with the only person that she still knows who runs an empanada shop. Murders begin to happen, and then all of a sudden there's this new mystery meat in the empanada that everybody loves. And what I love about this really kind of gruesome but funny series is that it looks at gentrification as a form of cannibalism, and then it kind of turns it on itself. It's brilliant.
All right, you got another one?
I do.
I don't know if you can top that, but...
Yeah, that's a hard one to top, the mystery meat and the empanada. My other one is Poker Face, and that is a series. It's kind of like a detective series starring Natasha Lyonne, and she really takes the grid of the old series Columbo and turns her own character out of that. And so she is kind of like the female Columbo. Each episode, she is in another place in the country solving a crime. She just plays this so wonderfully. Natasha Lyonne with her gravelly voice, chomping on a cigarette in this old, you know, late model car. It's just fantastic. And there's something really charming about taking that old network idea of a detective show and modernizing it.
How about, Jen, two older series? There were a number of big ones this year, including some that came to an end.
Well, you know, when I had to make my list of the top 10 shows and decide what number one was going to be, I had a long debate internally with myself, and then I was like, you're lying to yourself if you don't put Succession.
At the top.
At the top. Uh-huh. I mean, there was nothing that I was more obsessed with this year.
You and a lot of people.
And a lot of people.
I love you, but you are not serious people.
I just thought they ended that series perfectly. There was so much tension, just so many great performances. I mean, the death of Logan Roy, sort of the patriarch of the family. That episode alone, where the kids are finding out that their father died, was just an incredible hour of television. So I'm sad that it's gone, but a perfect way to go out.
Another one?
The Bear. That's my number two. Thank God it's still going. This was only the second season, but it had such a strong first season. It's about a man in Chicago who loses his brother and has to take over the family restaurant business. And in the second season, he's trying to do something totally different and do like a more elevated, sophisticated restaurant. And it's just so much fun to watch. You fall in love with the characters. I literally miss these characters every day that show is not on. I can't recommend it highly enough.
Lorraine, do you have a couple of older or perhaps even ending series?
Reservation Dogs. It was its third and final season, and this series did so much to kind of open up the everyday life on reservation, and the characters are indigenous, and they're playing kids that are kind of facing, you know, do we leave the reservation? Do we stay here? This final season wrapped up an incredibly nuanced and quirky series with tons of heart, but also this magic surrealism, and then also wrapping a lot of the history, painful history, of Native Americans and what they've gone through into a modern tale. And, you know, I love that series so much, and those characters will stay with me. My second pick would be Barry, which also wrapped up, the entire show wrapped up. This is, of course, the hitman turned actor. It's Bill Hader's HBO show. And I thought the ending of this would not be easy to wrap up, but they really nailed it. And they nailed it in a way that this hitman kind of comes off looking like a hero. And it just so speaks to our times of like everything being upside down and not what it should be morally. And I thought they just brilliantly nailed that.
You know, just in our last couple of minutes here, and I'll start with you, Jen. Can't really talk about this year without thinking about the strike. What have you seen in terms of any impact, or maybe more importantly, what are you looking toward? What will happen?
My concern going into 2024 is that in the wake of the strike, there was already a little bit of reticence to take risks in Hollywood, both in film and in television. And my concern is that it's going to be even more stark, that people are going to be IP-focused and not necessarily as interested in original stories. I hope I'm wrong, but I'm getting the sense from people in the business that that is kind of the direction, at least for now. And I think we're going to see constriction. You know, we have so many platforms, so many TV shows. Everyone's saying peak TV is over. And we're just not going to have as many shows, which is probably better for my sanity.
Yeah.
But it does reduce the number of possibilities for people that aren't represented on TV to have a place where they can be represented.
Lorraine, what do you see?
Much the same. I agree with what you're saying. And I also see, you know, when I'm looking forward to even what's coming out at the beginning of 2024, it's looking pretty stark. It's just there's not a lot there. And which makes me really grateful for what came out in 2023, because, you know, we've always complained, at least over the last 5 or 6 years, I'm never going to have enough time to watch everything.
Right.
Okay, well, 2024 is going to give you that time, because I think there's going to be, it's going to be kind of like scarce and scant pickings for a while. And I do, I'm also concerned about the idea that we're not going to get as much creative programming, but that's yet to be seen. Just go back, find what you haven't seen, which there's probably a lot of it. You'll have plenty of time to binge in the beginning of 2024.
Lorraine Ali and Jen Cheney, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, today is also the first day of Kwanzaa, a holiday celebrated by millions of African American families. You can learn more about the history of the holiday and how it's observed. You can go to our YouTube channel to do that. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Amna Nawaz. On behalf of the entire NewsHour team, thank you for joining us.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Pediatric Surgeon, Volunteer, Topiary Artist, a Raymond James Financial Advisor, tailors advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.